Hi everyone. Today I'm going to do another question from Ask Historians, but it's not going to be about tanks. If anything, it's going to be about the polar opposite of tanks. It's going to be about anti-tank rocket launchers. This question comes from user EhCanadianZebra, who asks, how come the Soviets never developed anti-tank rocket launchers? So he brings up quite fairly that the Americans had the bazooka, the Germans had the Panzerschreck and Panzerfaust, the British had a Piat, which is a whole different story altogether, but the USSR never fielded a rocket launcher in World War II. They kept on using their 14.5mm anti-tank rifles. So this is definitely, it's a valid question. The answer to that question is, well, they did. Experiments with rocket launchers began as soon as the fall of 1941, but the USSR had some very specific requirements when it came to rocket launchers. I think it's best demonstrated with what happened when the Lend-Lease bazooka was tested. So the USSR received about 3,000 bazookas as part of the Lend-Lease program in 1943. These were tested, and the results were, well, very negative. The muzzle velocity was considered very low. 89 meters per second was unacceptable. This resulted in a very high trajectory. The maximum range at which you could hit a tank was about 100 meters. Worst of all, at a temperature of less than 10 degrees Celsius, the trajectory changed drastically. So it would be much more difficult for the gunners to aim depending on the weather conditions. And all these things really just demonstrate what how different the requirements were between the U.S. Military, Germany, who loved the bazooka, developed their own upgraded version of it, and the USSR. In the USSR, the idea was that this rocket launcher has to replace the anti-tank rifle. The anti-tank rifle, of course, being useful at nominally up to a kilometer, more realistically probably about a couple hundred meters, but even so, you shouldn't have any issues hitting a tank-sized target with it, whereas with a bazooka or really any anti-tank rocket launcher of the era, you're probably going to have to get within maybe 50 meters, hopefully less, in order to actually hit a tank. So like I mentioned, the USSR tested its first anti-tank rocket launcher in August 6th of 1941 to demonstrate kind of this parallel between anti-tank rockets and anti-tank rifles. These launchers were called anti-tank rocket guns, essentially, and they were tested. This gun specifically was tested at a range that an anti-tank rifle was expected to hit a tank at, namely 1,000 meters. It did not hit from 1,000 meters. Even worse, the testers, since the firing was done at night, they didn't see where the rockets went and they couldn't find them. The longest range at which even a single rocket could hit a tank-sized target was about 100 meters, which was, this was not satisfactory for the army, so the project did not continue. In September of 1941, there was yet another rocket launcher project. This one wasn't man-portable, it was mounted on a motorcycle. So this was an 82mm air-to-ground RS-82 rocket. It was fired from a motorcycle-borne rail. This was also not entirely satisfactory. Precision was low, as it was noted. The rocket didn't rotate as it flew, flew every which way. And the ballistics weren't exactly the same, since the rail on the motorcycle was significantly shorter than it was on an aircraft. This project, based on the responses in the document, seemed fairly promising, but unfortunately it did not continue any further. In 1942, we start seeing more and more promising projects. There's a 96mm rocket launcher developed, of all organizations, by the People's Commissariat of Oil. This was a pipe that fired a fin-stabilized peat projectile, so something you would recognize as just a anti-tank rocket launcher in the traditional sense, but developed in 1942, definitely not a clone of the Panzerfaust like a number of people claim. This was, again, considered unsatisfactory. Specifically, the backblast from this gun was enormous, and again, it couldn't hit anything at over 100 meters. Now, these are drawbacks that were common to every anti-tank rocket launcher of the time, but unfortunately, the Red Army was very, very strict about these requirements. Now, there was another development in 1942 that was a little bit more promising. It was developed by an engineer called Mill. Mill's gun had a range of 150 to 200 meters, so it fired the same RS-82 rocket. A little bit more promising, but again, not the range wasn't long enough, and there was another drawback. The lighter version weighed 14 kilograms. The heavier version, which actually you'd have to transport it around on wheels rather than just carry it with you, weighed 20 kilograms. So this wasn't really the same class of weapon as a bazooka. And Neil himself intended it to be more like artillery in places where artillery couldn't easily get to. He suggested putting it on motorboats or having mountain units carry this thing around rather than lug around a heavy pack howitzer, and fired at concentrations of infantry from a kilometer away or a kilometer and a half. So it wasn't really a traditional anti-tank rocket launcher, but it was definitely in that ballpark. So now that I've covered all these failures, I'm going to tell you about two success stories, actually. You all probably know that the Red Army very happily used captured Panzerfausts. There were instructions written for them. They were captured by the tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands. There wasn't any need for the Red Army to produce their own. But these weren't the only rockets captured from the Germans that the Red Army used. Especially in Berlin during the heavy city fighting in 1945, the Soviet sappers would take Stukas-Ufos rockets. So you've probably seen them. They're like pretty big rockets in these wooden frames. Similar frames could also be made for Soviet M13 and M31 rockets that the Katyusha would use. So the sappers would fire these in these improvised frames directly at, well, they fired in building-sized targets, or like a door, a window, a breach in the wall to knock out enemy sniper or machine gun teams. So these things weighed about 130 kilograms, so they were quite difficult to manhandle up some stairs. You couldn't really carry them around with you everywhere you go, so they were used in special occasions when there was a particularly difficult target ahead of you. And they were aimed very simply, just three nails hammered into the frame. If you want to elevate or depress the gun, you just stack up some bricks. And then when it's time to fire, you go to a different room and you fire it remotely using an electrical cord because the back blast was quite significant. You don't want to be in the same room when it went off. So these were improvised, primitive, but very, very effective weapons. There's another success story with Soviet rocket launchers, but it's a bit of a long one. It actually began in April of 1943, where good results were finally obtained with firing the 82-millimeter rocket. This time, development was given to the professionals, so the scientists at the NI-3 and NI-6 research institutes. They developed a gun that could penetrate 90 to 100 millimeters of armor, which in April of 1943 was perfectly fine to defeat any German tank, including the Tiger. This gun had a range of about 300 meters, which again, pretty good. This was getting to the range that the army actually wanted to use its anti-tank guns at. So all around, fairly successful design. However, this design failed trials. It turns out that the extra range was gained by spin stabilizing the rocket. If you know anything about heat ammunition, you probably know that if you spin the warhead, the effectiveness of the heat jet drops. And so they found out that at a range of 300 meters, even though you could hit an enemy tank, you would not actually be able to penetrate the armor. And so development continued. So in June of 1944, they came out with the RBG-82 rocket-propelled grenade. So this grenade had a muzzle velocity of about 170 meters per second, about twice as fast as a bazooka, which gave it better trajectory, make it easier to hit things that are a couple hundred meters away. So the gun, which at that point was called RPR-82, it passed trials, but, well, only when the gunner was stationary. It turned out that when it came time to change positions, which, you know, anti-tank gunners often have to do, the thing was very long, very awkward to move around with. When you're trying to crawl, your leg gets caught in the blast shield. And again, the scientists went back to the drawing board. So improvements continued until March of 1945. At that point, they figured out most of the glitches. It was still big and awkward to move around with, but the launcher got little wheels to roll it around the battlefield. Penetration increased to 150 millimeters at 30 degrees, which again, very impressive for its time, could knock out basically any tank frontally. And special wintertime rockets were developed to correct that unfortunate side effect of rockets changing their ballistics when it gets cold. So development continued until the late 1940s. No one is exactly sure when this thing was accepted into service, but it was finally accepted into service way after the war was over as the SPG-82, which stands for Станковый противотанковый гранатомет, the mounted anti-tank rocket launcher. So this was a heavy, and I mean heavy, rocket launcher, but finally the USSR had its own domestic anti-tank rocket launcher that met its requirements, that could defeat, you know, armor used by armored vehicles of the time from a range that was considered acceptable. So as you can see, when you trace the history of Soviet RPG development, it starts quite a bit before they familiarize themselves with any foreign rocket launchers. And even once the Red Army saw them and tested them, they were still found to be unsatisfactory. Interestingly enough, the Piat, I know it was delivered to the USSR. I don't know how many. I've never seen it tested. One thing they liked about it was they liked the ammunition pouch. And so, this was back when it was the RPR-82. A Piat-style ammunition pouch was tested for this gun, but it was still rejected. But I digress. As you can see, these guns were tested, failed, but got back to the drawing board, rebuilt, and finally accepted into service without really influence from foreign designs.